Hey everyone, Nigel and Luke here, and welcome to Crime Zone. When it comes to female serial killers, the same handful of names tend to come up all the time. Aileen Wuornos, Judy Buenoano, Karla Homolka. Whether it's in the news or in crime books, television, or movies, you might get the impression that there are really no other female serial killers out there. And while it's true that there are quite a lot fewer of them than their male counterparts, as it's estimated that women only accounted for about 11% of serial killer cases in the past century, they are there nonetheless, and their crimes are every bit as terrifying. Today, we wanted to take a look at a few of these cases, focusing on stories of female serial killers you might not have encountered before. Before we get to our list, we wanted to take a second to remind everyone about Crime Zone's Patreon. In addition to ad-free versions of all of our content and weekly bonus videos for our Crimes of the Week and Crimes of the Week International videos, patrons will get exclusive monthly videos covering viewer-suggested cases. If you want even more Crime Zone content and are interested in helping to support the channel, head over to patreon.com/crimezone to sign up. We'd love to have you on board. With that out of the way, here are three lesser-known female serial killers. Though the shocking crimes of Leonarda Cianciulli seem to have gotten a little more attention in the true crime world as of late, we were surprised to find just how few lists her name appeared on when we began our research. The morbid story seems to offer a little bit of everything, from murder to cannibalism to paganism and the occult, earning Leonarda the disturbing nickname, the Soapmaker of Correggio. Leonarda was born in 1894 in the small southern Italian town of Montella, roughly 80 kilometers east of Naples. Her childhood was not a happy one. Her mother was emotionally abusive towards her children, and the family lived in poverty. This took an obvious toll on Leonarda, as she reportedly attempted to take her own life twice when she was still a young girl. Though sources disagree about the exact date, sometime between 1914 and 1917, Leonarda married a registry office clerk named Raphael Pensardi. This was not welcome news to either of her parents, who had planned to marry their daughter off to another wealthier man, and strongly disapproved of her marriage to Raphael. Leonarda would later say that her mother went so far as to place a curse on them. Leonarda had always been a highly superstitious person, and held a variety of pagan beliefs, often causing her to seek out advice and readings from fortune tellers. In particular, she received two eerie warnings that would stick with her and would later become part of the broader chilling narrative around her heinous crimes. The first fortune teller told her that she would marry and have children, but then all of her children would die young. The second told her during a palm reading that in her right hand she saw prison, and in her left she saw a criminal asylum. It was no wonder then that Leonarda was driven further into superstition and paranoia, when bad things seemingly began to follow her wherever she went. She was sent to prison for a fraud conviction in the 1920s, a few years after her and her husband moved to his hometown of Loria in Potenza. After her release, they moved to Lacedonia in Avellino, but their home was destroyed in the 1930 Irpinia earthquake. Amidst all of this, Leonarda reportedly got pregnant 17 times. Three of those pregnancies ended in miscarriages, and 10 of her children died while very young. As a result, Leonarda became increasingly protective and concerned about the safety of her remaining four children, particularly her eldest son, Giuseppe. For a time, things appeared to be calm. Leonarda, Raphael, and their children resettled all the way in northern Italy in Correggio, in the province of Reggio Emilia. There, Leonarda opened up a small shop, and she soon became well-liked and highly regarded by her friends and neighbors. However, in 1939, Leonarda got more distressing news. Giuseppe was going to join the Italian army, as the country headed towards the brink of World War II. Leonarda was desperate and willing to do anything to ensure her son's safety. She decided that the only way that she knew how to protect him was to offer human sacrifices. To commit her crimes, Leonarda took advantage of the trust and respect of her neighbors. Her first victim was a local unmarried woman named Faustina Setti, who Leonarda knew was desperate to find a husband. She told Faustina that she had found a suitable man in Pola, a city located on the Istrian Peninsula in what is now Croatia. Leonarda told Faustina not to share the news with anyone, but said that she should write some letters and postcards to friends and family before she left, which she could then send from Pola to let everyone know she was fine following her long journey. After Faustina had made all of her preparations, she stopped by Leonarda's house one final time to say goodbye. Once inside, Leonarda drugged her and killed her with an axe. However, this was only the start of Leonarda's gruesome plans. Following the murder, she separated Faustina's body into 9 pieces, gathering her blood in a large basin. She added the pieces to a large pot that she had bought for soap making, dissolved everything in highly corrosive caustic soda, and disposed of it. She then dried the blood, ground it, and mixed it with baking ingredients, which she used to make crunchy tea cakes, among other baked goods. The tea cakes were given to friends and acquaintances who came to visit, but were also eaten by Leonarda and Giuseppe. Finally, she kept the dead woman's life savings, which she had reportedly requested beforehand as payment for finding her husband. Though we could not find any reports that explicitly verified this, it's likely safe to assume that the postcards that Faustina had written before her death were sent out as planned by Leonarda to abate any suspicion about Faustina's sudden disappearance. Though this crime would have been disturbing enough on its own, it was just the beginning for Leonarda Cianciulli. In September of 1940, she would claim the lives of 2 more women in the area in a similarly grisly way. Leonarda's second victim was a woman named Francesca Suavi, for whom Leonarda claimed to have found a job at a school for girls. Like in the previous murder, Leonarda had Francesca write postcards to friends and family ahead of her apparent departure, so as not to raise suspicions. Francesca was lured to Leonarda's house a final time before she left, where she was drugged, killed, and disposed of in a similar fashion to Faustina. Again, Leonarda further capitalized on the crime by stealing money from her victim. However, it was the third and final killing that would not only lead to Leonarda's demise, but the coining of her chilling nickname. The victim was a woman named Virginia Cacioppo, a former singer for whom Leonarda claimed to have found yet another perfect job, a position as a secretary for a mysterious organizer and financier of operas in Florence. Like in the other 2 cases, Virginia was lured in by Leonarda's attractive offer, and again was told not to tell anyone about her sudden move, but instead to write letters and postcards to her friends and family. Though Virginia was murdered in a similar fashion, and her blood was again used to make a sickening assortment of desserts, this time Leonarda took things one step further. After boiling the remains in the same pot with caustic soda, she was intrigued by the texture, and decided to use the mixture to make soap. She would later describe this in chilling detail in a confession statement she prepared for police, noting how the woman's remains made for a particularly creamy soap, which she handed out to acquaintances and neighbors. She also remarked that this batch of baked goods turned out better than the last 2, and that the woman was, quote, really sweet. Again, Leonarda stole Virginia's money after the murder, this time making off with an additional haul of assorted valuables and public bonds. However, unlike with the previous 2 murders, someone became suspicious after Virginia's disappearance. A woman, described by some sources as her sister and by others as her sister-in-law, did not believe the story about Virginia's new job that she had detailed in her letter, and had actually seen her entering Leonarda's home on the night that she had allegedly left town. The woman reported this information to police in Reggio Emilia, who began to investigate Leonarda. Though Leonarda initially denied everything, she allegedly changed her tune once police began to theorize that her son Giuseppe might also have been involved in the crimes. She wrote her long and disturbing confession a short time later, making sure she was the sole person implicated in the murders. In 1946, Leonarda was tried and convicted for the killings. Sources say that she showed no remorse for what she had done, and actually went out of the way to correct details about the gruesome crimes during her trial. She was found guilty and sentenced to 30 years in prison, as well as 3 years in a criminal asylum. Leonarda died in October of 1970 of an intracerebral hemorrhage at a woman's criminal asylum in Pozzuoli. A number of the tools she had used in her killings, including her large iron pot and a copper ladle, were eventually put on display at the Criminology Museum in Rome, where they serve as a morbid reminder of Leonarda's gruesome crimes to this day. Do you know of any other cases like this that you think we should check out? Tell us about them in the comments section below. As always, if you enjoyed our video, don't forget to like and subscribe to Crime Zone for more true crime content like this, making sure to hit the notification bell to stay up to date with our latest releases. Thank you for watching.